Some folks like to get away, take a holiday from the neighborhood. Hop a flight to Miami Beach or to Hollywood.
I'm taking a Greyhound on the Hudson River line.
I'm in a New York state of.
Stars in the fancy cars and the limousines.
I've been high in the Rockies under the evergreens.
Under the evergreens.
But I know what I'm needing, and I don't want to waste more time. I'm in a New York state of mind.
Thank you. everyone. Welcome. We are so pleased to have you all here for At Lunch, an interview program hosted by Julie Salamon and the American Jewish Historical Society. My name is Rebecca Miller. I'm the manager of programming here at AJHS. AJHS is located in the Center for Jewish History just off of Union Square in New York City. We are pleased to say that we are once again open to the public, so please come and visit our exhibition spaces and reading room. We are the oldest cultural archive in the United States with over 30 million documents documenting the Jewish experience in the Americas from 1654 to the present. And today, we're very pleased to host our wonderful program At Lunch with our host, Julie Salamon. Julie is an American critic, author, and storyteller. She's worked at the Wall Street Journal for years, as well as the New York Times. She has gained fellowships at the McDowell Colony and become a Kaiser Media Fellow. She's written fiction and both nonfiction books for adults and children and has completed Unlikely Friends, recently a memoir for Audible Originals, and we hope you do check her out on this season of Turner Classic Movies' hit podcast, The Plot Thickens. Please welcome our host, Julie Salamon.
Hi, thank you so much, Rebecca, and welcome, everybody. I'm so excited to talk to Joshua Seftel, who made that wonderful video you just saw. Josh has had an eclectic and amazing career, one that includes directing the first season of Queer Eye for the Straight Guy, more recently a groundbreaking series called The Secret Life of Muslims. He's filmed conversations with his mother that became a regular feature on CBS Sunday Morning. And I hope she's in the audience today. And of course, the New York State of Mind video that began this program. He's done feature films and radio. His work has appeared on PBS, This American Life, CBS Morning News. His subject matter is wide-ranging, but there are common themes of humanity, social justice, and a sense of humor and hopefulness, which are things that haven't been that easy to hold on to these days. Josh, I thought the best way to talk about your career and life is through your work. We can't talk about all of it. We only have about 45 minutes or so, but we've picked certain pieces that I think really stand out. And let's start with this New York State of Mind. Could you tell us how it came about and what it took to make it? I mean, it's pretty extraordinary. So many performers in so many places. Welcome to At Lunch, Josh. Josh, are you there? Hold on a minute, we've lost Josh. We have a technical glitch here, but he will be on in a minute. Let me see while we're waiting. Rebecca?
Oh,
here he is. Josh will be on in 1 minute. Josh, I see you're
Hi.
Here.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, but can't see you.
Oh.
Josh is here. He'll be on in a minute.
Can you see me now?
Yes, there you are.
Okay,
so
I'm so
Josh,
sorry.
Josh, could you tell us a little bit about New York State of Mind and how it came about and how many
course.
People have seen it and what it took to make it?
Absolutely, yeah. So that project, you know, the pandemic was very odd for everybody, I think, and intense. And I don't know if you all remember, but there was a moment in time when someone wrote an op-ed that said, New York City is dead. And I'm trying to remember the guy's name, but a lot of people were, you know, disagreed with that. And I was one of them. And so a group formed called NYC Next. And it was a group of mostly creative people who said, no, New York's not dead and we're gonna show that it's not dead. And so there were a bunch of pop-up concerts that we did and around the city in all five boroughs. And we were just trying to show that there's still vitality here. There's still creativity here. There's still stuff happening. We did one event in Times Square where we had, I think it was something like 30 or 40 Broadway performers sing a Sondheim song on the TKTS steps. And my group made a little film about it. And so over time, we decided that we were gonna make a music video. And it was actually the idea of this guy named Tom Kitt, who's a musical director, Grammy winner, Tony winner. And he said, let's get the rights to New York State of Mind by Billy Joel. And we can have people all over the city. Yeah. And so that was the initial idea. And, you know, I came on to direct the video. And so what we did is we, you know, Tom arranged this track. And then we, you know, all kind of used our Rolodexes to figure out who we could get to be in the video. A lot of people were out of town. A lot of people, you know, moved out to the countryside or moved to LA or, you know, so it was challenging, but we were able to get a really interesting group of people. You know, we got Stephen Colbert and we got, you know, Sarah Bareilles and Idina Menzel and Zeeshan B and all sorts of interesting people to be in it. And it was really just such a fun, exciting project to be out in the city, going around with a camera again, filming people in kind of a joyous way. And you know, the video came out, it was on, it premiered on CBS Sunday Morning. Then it was, it kicked off the concert in Central Park, the reunion concert. And it's playing in like every taxi cab. I don't take cabs that much. I ride my bike lately, but I'm told it's in all the taxis. And I think the coolest thing was they were playing it at every Mets home game on the big screen. And I got to see a video of that. And it was just so cool. Everyone in the crowd was singing along, you know, and cheering. And it was just a great moment where I feel like the video helped bring the city together a little bit and help people to remember like how awesome New York is. So it was just a really special project that I was so excited to be a part of. Oh, I think you're on mute. I think you're still on mute.
There
we go.
All right, you should be proud of it. And I have to say, I've now seen this video several times and I still get a little, start crying a little bit when I see it.
Good.
It's really,
that's the intent.
I know, that was your point.
I like to make people cry if I can.
Yes, but in a good way, in a good cry. And, you know, so Josh, you really have started your career off in an incredible way at age 22. That was more than three decades ago with Lost and Found, the story of Romania's forgotten children. It was a documentary about the plight of Romania's 120,000 orphaned and abandoned children. And it was nominated for an Emmy. I mean, that's kind of a heady way to begin a career. Can you tell us how that got started? How you connected with that subject and what it was like to be so young and involved in a project like that?
Yeah, sure. So I was 22. I just graduated from Tufts University. And I had made one film while I was at Tufts. It was about my favorite professor. And, you know, I was pre-med. I had studied, did all the pre-med requirements, all the science, and I was planning to go to med school. And my dream was I was going to be, you know, I was going to join Doctors Without Borders and I was going to travel the world and I was going to like heal the world and go to like, you know, all over the world and help people. That was my goal. And my father was a doctor. And so he was really excited about it. My mom was a nurse. So they thought this was a great idea. And I'm, you know, a nice Jewish kid from upstate New York. So this was the right path was become a doctor. But I thought, let me take a year to make a film. And I had this opportunity to go to Romania through Tufts. One of my professors who saw the film I made about this professor I loved came to me and said, hey, would you want to go to Romania to make a documentary? We don't have any money, but there's this, you know, at the time the stories were coming out that all these children had been abandoned in Romania and orphaned. You know, there was over 120,000 children in the system. And so I thought, wow, what a great opportunity. I didn't know much about filmmaking, but I borrowed a video camera. I raised $2,000 to pay for my plane ticket. And I went over there with one of the first international relief teams. And I lived in the orphanages. I slept there overnight. I filmed everything I could. And it was incredibly intense and disturbing, sometimes very uplifting. But what I saw was, you know, children suffering, children being neglected, and just, you know, things you would see in a horror movie, really. And I was able to capture that well enough with my camera. And I came back and spent several months in an edit room learning how to edit, and also making this film. And the initial film was on PBS, and you know, it was just such a powerful story. The filmmaking almost didn't matter. You know, I was still a beginner, but the story can be everything sometimes. And the film just, you know, it led to the adoption of thousands of Romanian children, and it raised a lot of money. And, you know, I just thought, like, okay, I'm supposed to go to med school, but this filmmaking thing is pretty cool, you know, like this made an impact and it was tangible. And so at that point I thought, maybe I'll make one more film before I go to med school. And that was, you know, 30 something years ago. So I still haven't gone to med school.
But, you know, maybe you will, who knows? but I think you've done such incredible work. And, you know, full disclosure, Josh and I are both graduates of Tufts University, which is not why I chose him to come here. But I think a lot of people have found that kind of inspiration and mentorship through people, either at their schools or whatever. And I was really touched to hear this story. But I think in addition to the mentors and inspiration you found in school, it sounds like your parents have been huge inspirations to you. And for the last 8 or 9 years, you've been actually videotaping your conversations with your mother, who is, I saw on the guest list here today, which is very exciting. And these became a web series called My Mom and Movies. I think you've talked about all kinds of things, not just pop culture over the years. You've talked about a wide range of subjects. And these eventually became a periodic feature on CBS Sunday Morning. And I think millions of people have sort of tuned into your conversations with your mother, and some of them are actually quite hilarious and some of them are really heartrending. And so before we talk about that, rather than have people imagine what these conversations are, we'd like to play just a short clip from one of your conversations with your mom, and then we'll talk about how that came about. So Rebecca, can you play the clip?
Throughout this pandemic, we've been checking in with contributor Josh Seftel and his mom. This morning, the moment they've been waiting for, along with the rest of us.
Hello.
Have you started packing yet?
I did do my pills. Hello.
It's hard to believe you haven't met Madeline and she's already 10 months old. Are you excited to meet her?
I can't wait. I really waited a long time.
What are you doing to get ready physically for this trip and for meeting the baby?
My trainer, Penelope, brought this great big weight.
Wow.
And I've been exercising with that.
Do you think of it as a little baby?
If I'm cradling it, I might, but when I'm swinging it, I don't.
About 5 months ago, I said, well, you're gonna hold that baby. Why don't we start training for the baby? And she just, that big smile, and she was so excited.
Nice baby. The baby is 19 pounds. I don't wanna drop her.
Maybe we should do push-up.
Are you getting stronger?
My arms are.
You know, the baby is actually getting in shape too, pushing on things and lifting herself up.
That's right.
Good girl.
Do you feel like you know her?
Yes, she's happy. She loves her food. She takes after me. Oh, wait a minute, I think she's here.
What's your relationship like with my mom?
I adore her. All through COVID, I've traveled to her once a week and I love her.
Why'd you do that for my mom?
After 2 weeks, you could tell she was overwhelmed, she was scared, she cried on the phone, and it just broke my heart.
What did you think when the pandemic first started?
It was unbelievable. When I realized that it was no end in sight, it really started bothering me.
What do you think it's been like for her?
But in the beginning, I think she felt a little bit abandoned.
She's been more alone than she's ever been in her entire life.
I remember mom being really present and important when people in the family had babies. She would come in and be like this very knowing and confident guide.
It's almost like her job as a grandma, she hasn't been able to do it for the last year.
Right.
How's the training going?
It's going okay.
Now take a break.
Oh. Do you ever feel like Rocky?
You mean when he was running up the steps?
Mm-hmm.
That music was pretty good, wasn't it?
Going all the way up. Fast, fast.
Are you feeling strong? Are you feeling ready?
I mean, I can lift. It's just I don't know if I can lift 20 pounds.
I think she might have gained a pound.
Oh, no.
Are you done with the training for now?
Yes.
You feel like you're ready?
We'll see.
When is mom coming?
At 12:05 p.m.
How do you think she's feeling about meeting the baby?
I think she can't wait to hold her.
I think she's going to be kind of speechless.
What do you think this means to her?
I think it's kind of like all she wants, really, to make the world right.
Grown hat. There she is.
Oh my God!
There she is. You dig out. There's mom.
Hi, mom. How are you?
What was it like to meet the baby?
It was a beautiful sunny day. And all of a sudden, you guys brought the baby over to me.
Hello, Madeline. Hello, my sweet baby. Hello.
Oh my God, she's so cute. I was so happy.
Do you think the workouts paid off?
Oh, absolutely. I lifted her up. Whoa.
What did she feel like?
Heavy.
From behind, there was a similarity in your arms.
She's a Zoftik baby. That's Yiddish for chubby.
Was there much eating going on?
Oh my God. Didn't you think there was a lot of food?
I think it's kind of all we did was eat.
You're crawling up.
You know, I keep reliving those few days. It's like a dream came true.
Are you looking forward to seeing the baby again soon?
Yes, I am. We're going to see each other in Cape Cod.
So are you going to keep training?
Of course. My trainer's coming Thursday.
Because she's only going to get heavier.
I know.
Okay, Josh, you did it again. I'm a little mascara streaking, I think. Wow, that was just really beautiful. And I think you touched on feelings that many people have been having over the last year and a half being separated from our families. But you were making these films long before the pandemic and couldn't have anticipated this. But how did you start filming these conversations with your mom?
Yeah, so it started about, 9 years ago, maybe. It was a little after my father passed away. We decided to buy my mom an iPad. And my sisters and I discussed it, and there was some debate about, you know, can she really master it? Would she like it? And we took the leap and we did it. And over time, I started doing FaceTime calls with her. She learned how to do FaceTime. And I started to think, like, God, these conversations, I should be recording them because they're kind of priceless. And then I started to play around, and I remember I edited one into a little film and I put it on YouTube, and it got a lot of response. And that was when I started working with CBS a little bit, CBS Sunday Morning, to share these. And I think there's something universal about it, clearly. You know, it's, I think my mom is really, for other people, I think they like her. And I also think she becomes a stand-in, you know, for people in their life that either they don't get to talk to as much as they would like, or people that aren't around anymore that they wish they could talk to. And that's what we see in the comments that we get. I mean, we get, you know, thousands of comments from people and fan mail. I mean, my mom is famous. Like, she, I'm not kidding. Like, when we go out, you know, it's during the pandemic, not as much, but even with her mask on, people come up to her and say, I know you, I know who you are, I recognize your voice. And, you know, she'll be in the grocery store, people will come up to her, in restaurants. People send her gifts in the mail, matzo ball soup, mahjong sets. Someone drew a cartoon strip about her. I mean, it's really, there's something that resonates with people about my mom.
Yeah, well, I think she's obviously an incredible person and such a strong-willed, in the best sense of being strong-willed person. But also, it's interesting because you said she was a nurse before, so she spent her life helping people. And it's kind of amazing that now she's helping people in a different way just by being such a life force, really. It's wonderful. I really thank you for having the impulse to start filming her. It's incredible. You know, when we talked earlier, you said you had gotten a comment from somebody after they saw one of the films with your mom that was like, oh, that's so Jewish, or something like that. And I was wondering how you took that, as a compliment or as a...
Right. Yeah. I mean, mostly we get positive comments. I would say 99%. If there's 1,000 comments, maybe less than 10 are negative. But I think it was a negative comment, honestly, that someone said, oh, it's so Jewish, because it was also couched in another negative thing. I don't know. You know, it's funny. I didn't think of it as being very Jewish, but maybe we just exude that, you know. And it's our culture. So if people don't like it, they can watch something else. But I don't know what it exactly meant. I can't even speculate.
Yeah, I mean, it was funny to me when you said that, because I felt, yes, I see that. You know, obviously you see there's a mezuzah on somebody's house and, you know, matzo ball soup. But on the other hand, the relationship is very universal. And I think the longing to be reunited with family is very universal. But it does lead me to my next question and the next film series that I'd like to talk about. When we had initially talked about having this conversation and I asked you about Jewish identity, we are at the American Jewish Historical Society, you brought up this series that I wasn't expecting you to talk about as somehow touching on your Jewish identity. And it's a really remarkable series of short, really almost profiles you've done of American Muslims. It's called The Secret Life of Muslims. And it's just very, again, like all of your work, very human peeks into the lives of people from all different walks of life, people who have a particular ethnic identity, but are Americans. And I'd like to show just a brief clip from this series, and then we can talk a little bit more about how it got started and why you wanted to do it.
Both of our moms are annoying as hell. Like, we could all just like commiserate about our mothers, like, ugh.
I think as Muslims, we're very aware that the Jewish people are our cousins.
I mean, Jews and Muslims have so much in common. Both communities have been shat upon by Americans for most of the last century. The experience that Muslims are having right now in America is the exact same experience that Jews had in this country 60, 70 years ago.
We're closer to Jews than any other religion. When you say Abraham, you know, I say, oh yeah, I know Abraham. When you say Moses, I say, yeah, of course I know Moses.
Food has always been the one thing that Jews and Muslims have always united on.
Halal means things that are kosher. The whole idea is that you're not slaughtering animals in an inhumane fashion.
The Prophet Muhammad was very clear about this. He was like, well, what do the Jews do? And he was told what the Jews did, and he goes, okay, well, let's do that.
I really feel for my Jewish brothers and sisters, because sometimes you really just want that Big Mac, and you can't have it.
Islamic dietary laws, Islamic marriage and inheritance laws, and Islamic purity laws are borrowed almost completely from the Jews of Arabia.
If Jews and Muslims would just realize that one of them is an older brother, the other one's a younger brother, and they should just get along together, the world would be a better place.
The Quran says he only made you different so you get to know each other, different tribes, different cultures, backgrounds, just so you get to know each other.
As religious minorities, it's important for us to stand together and to be united.
Let's start with a hummus and see where it takes us.
Great. So as always, you know, it's all we hear about in general about everything is conflict. I mean, the way the media, which I've grown up in, portrays everything, it's always conflict. And certainly there is a lot of conflict in the world. But I think you have specialized in finding the really large places of commonality of humanity. And I want you to talk about Secret Lives of Muslims. I also want to tell people in the audience, if you'd like to ask a question that I'm not asking, you can put it into the Q&A section on your screen. But Josh, if you could tell us how this series got started and how you found the people to participate in it and what was the whole process?
Sure. Yes, that it was like 8 years ago that I started thinking about it, maybe longer. And the idea was like, to make a series of very short films, very shareable films. Like the idea was, you know, you could post them online or put them in your Facebook feed and people could share them. And I wanted to tell stories of American Muslims that weren't being told. And the reason why was because I was seeing a lot of Islamophobia, like many people, we all see it in our world. And I connected to how it must feel to be Muslim. You know, I as a Jew growing up in upstate New York, you know, in Schenectady, we faced anti-Semitism. You know, in my school there weren't many Jews, and kids called me names, Jew Kike, Jewish Josh. Kids threw pennies at me because they were trying to show that I was cheap. Someone threw a rock the size of a brick through the front window of our home. And you know, it was just something that I hadn't thought about a lot for a long time, but when I started working on trying to do this series, it all kind of came back to me. And I felt a connection to wanting to do something. So we took this idea out, we pitched it. And at the time it was like probably 2015, 2014. And we couldn't get any funding. And then about a year and a half later, the presidential campaign started to heat up. And, you know, when Trump was coming out and saying certain things, one of our funders who had said no, reached out to me and said, hey, what's going on with that Muslim short film project you're doing? And they said, because we're interested in funding it now. And so that really set it in motion. So we have Donald Trump to thank for this series. So we went out and we made, you know, I think the first season we did 13 short films. And, you know, they were very popular. They were, I think we had the first in season one, we had 35 million views. And we got nominated for an Emmy and a Peabody. But it was just, you know, it just, the best part was that were the comments that we saw on social media. You know, we'd see, like, I remember there was one comment I love where this young woman posted the video and tagged her mother. And she said, "Mom, watch this film. This is what I've been trying to explain to you." And it was just beautiful. You know, it was like, that's exactly what we were hoping for, is people sharing these things with people they love. To try to build bridges and create better understanding. And so it's been, you know, probably one of the most meaningful projects I've gotten to work on in recent years. And we're continuing to make, we're doing season three right now, actually, of Secret Life of Muslims. So you can, if you want to check out more episodes there, you can just Google it, and there's they're all over the internet.
Wow. So I'm curious, have schools been using these at all for discussion points, or do you know? Because it seems like it would be such a valuable thing for kids to also see.
Yeah, they're part of a curriculum. And it's through, I'm trying to remember the group, oh my gosh. It's the group that educates about the Holocaust and genocide.
Facing history, right. That's wonderful. Oh, that's such a great thing.
Yeah, so Facing History has made it a part of their curriculum, and it's out there. It's, you know, lots of people are seeing it, and I hope it's, you know, in some small way helping to create some understanding. That's you know, it stems back to that initial thing. I haven't gone to med school yet and joined Doctors Without Borders, but hopefully I can do these little things that have a little impact.
I don't think it's a little thing. I actually think it's a pretty big thing. So many people are seeing it, and just to spark that thought process, I think is so, so wonderful. And as you talked about how you did this on, you know, you posted onto YouTube, one of the things that you said to me earlier that I thought was so interesting was just to talk about, if you could, a little bit about how the trajectory of what it's like to be a filmmaker these days and how it's changed. I mean, I'm sure when you started out, it was, you know, there were four TV stations and, you know, very limited, there was no internet, you know, so you either had to fit into that very tiny little box. How have you seen that in your own career, just in terms of the way you think about distribution?
Yeah, it's changed so much. You know, I think one of my first films, I remember, it was called Taking on the Kennedys. It was a documentary about a guy who ran for Congress. And I remember after it was released, you know, they gave me this binder full of reviews. You know, the film had been reviewed in like every major newspaper in the United States. Half of those newspapers don't even exist anymore, right? But that would never happen today, you know? There's so much content, and you know, no one's. It used to, you know, that when that film came out, I got phone calls from so many people, you know, like Judd Apatow and Alec Baldwin and Rob Reiner all cold called me, because back then everyone was watching the same thing, right? And now that it's just not the world we live in, and so over time I've just tried to try lots of different things. You know, I've made documentaries, I've directed movies, I've directed short films and web series and commercials and radio, I've done This American Life, you know, and it's sort of makes it's more interesting to me to have a career like that. I've been told one day an agent took me aside and said, he was asking me what I do and I explained it all. And he said, oh, so you're a jack of all trades. And I thought, oh my gosh, that's not good. You know, like that, what's the rest of that sentence? But I think that as the world has changed, I think that idea of being a specialist is maybe old fashioned. And I think that having diversity and doing lots of different things is sort of in vogue and gives you an advantage these days. I know during the pandemic, it helped me and my company because we were diverse and, you know, in the work that we do. And that allowed us to navigate because, you know, certain things dried up and certain things became more popular and we were able to balance and move forward. And so, it's also just more interesting to do a wide range of things. So I'm enjoying that. You know, I don't know what the future holds for the business, but I feel like my attitude is like, I don't know how many years I have left in the business, but like, I want to keep trying new things and doing the things I want to do while I still have time to. So that's kind of my approach. So if I feel like I want to do a web series with my mom, I'm going to do it. You know, if I want to do a thing about American Muslims, I'm going to go try to do it. So that's kind of my approach.
Well, it feels like it's been a pretty good approach so far. So we just have a couple minutes left. I'd love for you to tell us if you have any new projects that people could be looking for that you've been involved with. And also, is there a project that you dreamt about doing that you haven't done yet, but that's sort of your pie in the sky?
Yeah, well, so the newest project, well, you saw the music video at the beginning, that's quite new. Another new project that we just did is, it's a documentary and it's actually, it's about a US Marine who came back from years of combat and he moved into Muncie, Indiana, and he was very damaged from his time abroad and he had PTSD. And he decided that he was going to blow up the mosque in his town. And he built a bomb and he went to the mosque to case it out. And the congregants of the mosque saw him outside. They invited him. True story.
Josh.
Can you hear me?
You broke up a little bit. You were just saying that the people outside the mosque saw him, and then what happened?
So they saw him and they invited him in. And that is where the story begins of this documentary. And wow. It's going to be coming out soon. Hopefully you'll hear about it and we'll keep people posted, but that's our latest thing. And so it's sort of a spin-off of the stories we've been telling about American Muslims.
That sounds amazing. Really wonderful. Well, I can't tell you what a pleasure it's been to talk to you, to see a little taste of your work, and look forward really to seeing what you do next.
Thanks, Julie. It's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in.